Thank you all very much, and welcome to Town Hall. I cannot tell you how delighted I am to be here and to have the opportunity, the privilege, and honor to introduce Phyllis Bennis. I am here on behalf of, as you heard, Seattle Pacific University and Friends of Sebille North America, which is an organization dedicated to the support of Sebille, an ecumenical liberation theology movement founded by Palestinian Christians in the Holy Land. To introduce Phyllis, I want to begin with a quotation from Richard Falk, who, among other things, is Professor Emeritus of International Law at Princeton University. He wrote this about 3 weeks ago in the Electronic Intifada, which I encourage all of you to go online and find and read. So he's talking about Makiram Wibisono, who announced his resignation as UN Special Rapporteur on Human Rights in the occupied Palestinian territories. And as Falk writes, this is the position I held for 6 years until June of 2014. The Indonesian diplomat says that he could not fulfill his mandate because Israel has adamantly refused to give him access to the Palestinian people living under its military occupation in the West Bank and the Gaza Strip. Quote, unfortunately, my efforts to help improve the lives of Palestinian victims of violations under the Israeli occupation have been frustrated every step of the way. Falk goes on. It is worth recalling that when Wibisono was elected as my successor, several more qualified candidates were passed over. Although the selection guidelines stress expert knowledge of the subject matter of the mandate, Wibisono gained the upper hand precisely because of his lack of any relevant background. Falk continues, I can only hope that now the UN Human Rights Council will redeem its mistake by reviving the candidacies of Professor Christine Chinkin and Phyllis Bennis, both of whom possess the credentials, motivation, and strength of character to become an effective special rapporteur. So who is Phyllis Bennis? She's a career political activist who's been active in the Middle East since the 1970s. She witnessed the First Intifada, began to take a serious interest in pro-Palestinian advocacy at the time. She made three additional trips to the Middle East, and this led to her book, From Stones to Statehood, The Palestinian Uprising, a book published in 1990, in which she describes the first 2 years of the Intifada and makes the case for a Palestinian homeland. She's written extensively on Palestine. One of her earlier books is in a new edition, the sixth edition, perhaps, that has just recently been published. Unfortunately, it's not here, but I strongly encourage you to take a look at that. Phyllis is a founding member of the U.S. campaign to end the Israeli occupation, established in 2002 during the Second Intifada. She is a leader of the United for Peace and Justice organization. She's the author of 9 books, co-editor of 2 others. Most recently, the book that she is here to talk about, Understanding ISIS and the New Global War on Terror. And there are copies of this over at the University Bookstore table, and I highly recommend it. It is subtitled A Primer, and it is just a terrific introduction to really the larger issue here, the background of ISIS, not just what has been happening currently. She has contributed articles to many journals, The Nation, The Baltimore Sun, newspapers. She has many media appearances as well, CNN, the PBS NewsHour, BBC, NPR. She has also spoken, she also spoke at a memorial for Rachel Corrie on the 10th anniversary of Rachel's death in 2013. And I want to highlight that in particular, one of the co-sponsors and a primary force in bringing Phyllis here tonight is the Rachel Corrie Foundation. They have a table over by the university bookstore table as well. Cindy and Craig are here. So please, at the end of this talk, wander over there and say hello and take a look at the materials that Cindy and Craig have available. And now, please join me in welcoming Phyllis Bennis.
Good evening. Somehow the mics are always too high. They were built for taller people. Thank you all for coming tonight. I don't know if I should say this, but part of me wants to say thank you for being down here and not up there. Although it could be interesting. That's not at all a theological statement. Highly construction and you know, levels. But I do think that the coalition of forces is an aspiring one for tonight. This is very interesting. You know, 2 weeks ago was the 25th anniversary of the first US war against Iraq in 1991. It's hard to imagine that it was that far away. It's 25 years. But if we look back at that, we can really see there the origins of the set of policy catastrophes of our country that led directly to the creation of ISIS in 2004. There's a direct line. I want to ask a question, but I can't see a thing with these lines. How many of you have heard, I'm not asking if you believe it, but how many of you have heard that ISIS was created when President Obama pulled the troops out of Iraq? Heard it, not believed it. Come on, admit it. All right, most of you know you've all heard it anyway. You're just not willing to admit it. But okay, we don't have to go there. But the point is, we know exactly when and how ISIS was created. We know its origins. That part, unlike some others, is not a mystery. And it was not in 2011 when President Obama pulled out the troops for a brief time. It was in 2004 when President Bush was supervising 150,000 US and NATO troops that were occupying Iraq. That's what gave rise to ISIS. Not the withdrawal of troops, the presence of troops. And if we look back 25 years, we can also see a trajectory that has led to what we're now seeing, the crisis in Syria, the 8 or 9 separate wars all being fought to the last Syrian, the disaster of Libya as a result of US NATO regime change, these crises across the Middle East that has led to a new global war on terror. Today's an anniversary as well. You all know this. This is Groundhog Day. So what's the deal with Groundhog Day? It's not the little thing they pull out of his, you know. I mean, these guys are nocturnal. They don't want to come out in the middle of the day anyway. It's like, where's PETA saying this is animal abuse? But it's not really about that. It's about this notion of repeating things. You know, it was Einstein who had this great line about the definition of insanity is doing the same thing over and over again and expecting a different result. That hasn't changed. The US is repeating its policy over and over again and thinking that because it's a different president doing the same thing with a slightly different tactic that somehow it's going to work better. When we found out, we have a new report saying that conditions in Afghanistan are worse than ever, and the Taliban now has control of more territory than at any moment since it was overthrown in 2001. And the answer is, well, let's send more troops. Yeah, because we did so well the first time around. You know, it's this notion of Einstein was wrong. We can do the same thing over and over again, and we will get a different result. Oh, really? How's that working for you so far? You know, this is a serious problem that we're facing here. In Groundhog Day, this notion of repetitive action is very much at the root of what we have to challenge today. You know, one of the things that happened when President Obama took office, on the second day in the White House, he sent a memo. They're very big on memos in the White House. The memo went to the State Department, to the Pentagon, to the White House staff, to everybody, saying, we don't want to use the term global war on terror. That was Bush's war. We're not doing that. We want to call it something different. We're going to call it overseas contingency operations. How Orwellian is that? This notion that you can call it with such a benign name, overseas contingencies. It's like there was a flood and we're sending some operators to help rescue people. No, this is a war. Call it what it is. I always like the term global war on terror, partly because the initials, the acronym GWAT, always had that evil sound, right? This isn't exactly the same, certainly. It's not relying on hundreds of thousands of troops. From the vantage point of US troops, that's a good thing. From the vantage point of how many Iraqis and Syrians and Afghans are dying, not so great. Yesterday's New York Times had a fascinating op-ed by a former army captain, and the little jump quote in the middle of it, it's an article about special forces and how critical they have become, how central they have become to US strategy in the region. And it describes top secret missions, mythical warriors, and a state of perpetual warfare. That's what US policy looks like today. We hear from President Obama a very important point, which is absolutely true and crucially important. And I so wish he would make it good. He says over and over again, there is no military solution. And you want to shake him and say, well, then why is it that every action we see is a military action? Because then he adds something that isn't true. He says, you know, the military action isn't enough. We also are going to need some diplomacy and negotiations and economic things and some other things. That's wrong. The problem isn't that the military isn't enough. The problem is that the military actions make all those other crucial actions impossible. Because if you're an ordinary Sunni Iraqi, say, and you see the US coming and bombing, maybe it's an ISIS camp not far from your village, and maybe they get some ISIS people, but in the meantime, they've also bombed a few others. And the response in Washington is, yay, we got the bad guys. And the response in Iraq is, yeah, there's the Americans again, bombing the Sunnis in the interests of the Shia and the Kurds. So we're exacerbating the sectarianism. We're furthering the divide among the Iraqi people that we helped put in place when we overthrew a regime, a repressive regime, no doubt, but left this new system in place that was based deliberately, consciously, on imposing a sectarian-based system of political parties that had never existed in Iraq before. That's the challenge that we face now. And this is now a global war, again. Yes, the US is leading, not a surprise. We spend more than the top 9 other countries, including China, including all of our so-called enemies, more than all of them together. We spend billions and billions of dollars, hundreds of billions of dollars on the military every year, something most other countries are smart enough not to do. So it's not surprising that our assumption is that if there's a problem, it's going to be the military that has the solution. It's the old hammer and the nail. If you're a hammer, everything looks like a nail. If you're the Pentagon, everything looks like it needs a military solution. The problem is that seems to be the problem in the White House and in the State Department and in Congress as well. For any of us, if we have a problem, call the Marines. That's a serious problem. Because put aside international law, put aside the morality of killing innocent people, inevitably, and just look at the success. You can't find it. Because the military solutions are failing. They've failed in the past, they're failing now, and there is absolutely zero reason to think they're going to succeed in the future. So this notion of saying that, well, San Bernardino changed everything. Paris changed everything. Ankara changed everything. None of these incidents change everything, except for the victims and their families. For them, yes, it changes everything. But it doesn't change the world. It was the same for us on 9/11. We had never experienced, no one in this country was alive the last time the United States was attacked. Pearl Harbor was not in a US state. Hawaii wasn't even a state at that time. Nobody was alive when we were attacked from outside. So it was not surprising that people were paralyzed with fear. But the reality was, as horrific a crime as 9/11 was, a crime against humanity, it did not pose an existential threat to the United States. It did not threaten our democracy. It did not threaten our country. What threatened our country and continues to threaten, what threatened our democracy and continues to threaten, is what happened on September 12th, not September 11th.
When the president announced that the response to this horrific crime would be to take the world to war, we were given the choice. We either go to war or we let them get away with it. You're either with us or you're with the terrorists. And if you're not with us, we will treat you as if you too were a terrorist. And we have treated people around the world and in our own country as if they were terrorists from that day forward. The problem is, you can't bomb terrorism out of existence. You can't bomb terrorism at all. You can only bomb people. You can bomb cities. Sometimes you might get lucky. You might hit a terrorist. You might kill a terrorist. But that doesn't eliminate the terrorism. It just creates more. There is no military solution. The solution lies in changing the conditions that give rise to terrorism in the first place and that make people's lives so desperate that they're prepared to embrace a level of horrific, violent terrorism because it still seems better than what they have at home. That's what we can change. Not fast, it's not sexy, doesn't make good television, but it's the only thing that will work. The talks that began in the last couple of days in Vienna, the Syria talks, I don't know if it's going to work. It's hugely problematic because it's really 9 separate wars that are being fought, all to the last Syrian. But the people who are at the table first are not any Syrians. It's the supporters, the outside supporters. Now, maybe that's what has to happen first. Maybe there has to be an agreement on a ceasefire between the US and the Saudis and Turkey on the one hand and Russia and Iran on the other hand before you even bring in the Syrian regime and the Syrian opposition. Is that fair? Of course not. Is it just? Of course not. But the goal here is not about winning the war, it's about stopping a horrific war. And those who are trying to win it are not going to be happy by simply stopping it where it is, stopping it in place. But that's probably what needs to happen first. And it's not at all clear that Di Mistura and his team from the United Nations are going to be able to pull that off. What we do know is that the potential for broadening the diplomacy over war that was represented in the US-Iran nuclear deal, the potential for broadening that to a much bigger level of normalization between those two countries, is not a done deal. It's still a possibility, but it may be that there is just not the willingness, more likely in Washington than in Tehran. There's problems in Tehran too, but the problems are more likely to come from Congress than from the hardliners in the Iranian Majlis, in the Iranian parliament. We don't know if that's going to work. It is a possibility, but the US has been responding militarily, bolstering its military support of the Saudis as they take on Iran in the region, bolstering US support for the Saudi war in Yemen. None of this is going to help in the effort to broaden the victory of diplomacy over war that was represented in that Iranian nuclear deal. The military strategy is still failing. And every time we hear presidential candidates saying, I would do it better. I would light up the sands. I would use nukes. I would take them out. This is a serious problem. This is what the world is hearing from our elections. Who can outdo the next one in the talk of killing more people around the world? In the name of keeping Americans safe, when the reality is it puts us at much greater risk. It doesn't keep us safe. It's what engenders more anger and more terrorism at the end of the day. If we look right now, we have been at war against terrorism for 15 years. And where do we stand now? Suddenly ISIS is controlling territory. The Taliban, according to new military reports 2 days ago, now control more territory than they have since 2001. The Pentagon spends $500 million to create and train a Syrian opposition force that would be loyal to the United States, that would go after ISIS and wouldn't go after Assad, and would do things our way and be democratic and secular and not touch any of the Islamist forces. And what happened? They couldn't find any. Well, not entirely true. They found 54. No, they found 54. They sent them in to fight, and within 2 days, half of them had either defected, been killed, or put down their weapons and fled. The other 26 went back to fight, and they were almost all killed. $500 million. It comes out to pretty much, I can't do the math, but it's like more than $1 million each to train these guys. I mean, talk about a bad use of money. And ISIS still controls territory. Yes, they have lost some territory in recent months, and the U.S. tells us that's a great victory. Ramadi has been free of ISIS. Well, you could argue that's a victory. Defeating ISIS pretty much anywhere should be seen as a victory. But what did it really mean on the ground? ISIS had done enormous damage, not only to people, but to the city of Ramadi. But it was the U.S. bombing that finished it off. Those who have survived the siege of Ramadi have nothing to go back to. Their town is in ruins. It goes back to the Vietnam era. We had to destroy the village in order to save it. But this was no village. This was a city of 300,000 people. And the survivors of those 300,000 have no city to go back to. It's been destroyed. And in the meantime, ISIS is now going back to its old form of soft target terrorism. As they lose more territory. Yeah, we can use the military for that. That would probably work. We can reduce their control of territory. And what happens? They go back to another form of terror. That's not a solution, because it's done nothing to change the conditions that result in an ordinary Sunni doctor going off to join ISIS because it seems like a lesser evil than the horrific sectarian government in Baghdad that we are keeping in power. So Obama is right when he says there is no military solution. The problem is there's no one holding him accountable to his own words. And that failure, it means that you have to do something different. You have to learn from what the genius taught us, that you can't keep doing the same thing and expect a different result. So what does that look like? In Afghanistan, the new report that just came out from the special investigative, the special inspector general, the Taliban controls more territory. That of the $113 billion the U.S. has spent on education, this is supposedly the great thing we've achieved, right? At least we got the kids in school. Well, turns out, not so much. Of the $113 billion, $17 billion is just over 3 years, is already lost to corruption. And the main claim, we've got the kids, especially the girls, into school. It turns out that right now, 42% of Afghan children of elementary school age have either never been to school or have already dropped out. We have failed, and we have been lied to about what the war has brought to the people of Afghanistan. So when we look at this question, what was the origin of ISIS? There's a reason that I start sometimes by asking, you know, how many people have heard this line that ISIS began when the troops were pulled out? Well, they became visible in Syria around that same time, but their origins were years before. They changed their name, they changed what they believed in. They're a very changeable batch of fighters. But their history began fighting against foreign occupation in 2004. So when we look at that, we have to look at the impact that that has had on people in the region, on people around the rest of the world, and recognize what it means. Why are they so powerful? How did this happen? It's because they don't fight alone. Because when the U.S. went into Iraq and invaded Iraq, the first thing it did was to dissolve the military and throw out all the generals and all the colonels, and quite a ways down, I think as low as the sergeants. And all those people suddenly had lost their job, lost their privileges, sent home with no way to support their family, nothing but their weapons that they took with them. And they've been seething ever since. They've been angry ever since. They've been looking for revenge ever since. And ISIS shows up, and that's where they find it. So that's who's providing the military strategy and the training and the weapons training of all of that. It's not the ISIS militants themselves, they didn't just figure out how to do all this stuff. It's they've got the top generals that fought under Saddam Hussein. And those generals, quite frankly, were pretty good generals. They knew how to fight. That's why ISIS is having success now. So what does all this mean? What do we do about all this? We can look at all the origins of the crisis, and there are many. The role of climate change is huge here. The drought that began in Syria in 2006 and went through about 2010 drove somewhere like 800,000 farmers off their land. Syria was once the breadbasket of the region. That's where the wheat grows. And suddenly there was no rain, so there was no wheat. Farmers couldn't make a living, so they flooded into the cities looking for jobs. But neoliberalism had come to Syria in those last years, so there were no jobs. There were a few, but the few jobs go to somebody who knows somebody in power. That was more likely to be an Alawite who knew some other Alawite family because the Alawites were privileged. And so you're exacerbating again the sectarianism that hadn't really been that much of an issue in Syria. Before the crisis, Syria had had a huge middle class. It had the smallest wealth-poverty gap in the whole region. So now, there's people that are desperate. That's what leads to an uprising. That's what created the initial, what seemed so optimistic, the Arab Spring coming to Damascus. And then the repression sets in by this dictatorial regime. And then the war begins, and suddenly it expands, and it's now, as I said, it's at least 8 or 9 separate wars. It's regional wars between Iran and Saudi Arabia being fought to the last Syrian. It's also a religious war between Sunni and Shia, also between Iran and Saudi Arabia being fought to the last Syrian. It's a war between the US and Russia over things like naval bases and sea lanes being fought to the last Syrian. At the moment, it's also a war between Turkey and the Kurds, partly being fought to the last Syrian. So the question of how do we stop this war and what do we have to do to stop ISIS and stop the Syrian war become enormous challenges. What are we doing wrong? Well, if you look from August of 2014, when the US began its war against ISIS, the people of Washington State alone have paid $154 million in taxes. Your money, just for that brief period, just for the war against ISIS. That doesn't count the war in Afghanistan. That doesn't count the war in Iraq that was already underway. It doesn't count the military budget. It doesn't count the bases. It doesn't count the nuclear weapons. It doesn't count anything except for just the so-called war against ISIS. If you had kept that money at home, here's a couple things you could have done with it. You could have had 1,524 kids in Head Start every year for 10 years. You could have had 1,624 veterans getting health care every year for 10 years. You could have 4,219 students getting 4-year scholarships to the university. What makes us safer? Jobs and health care and education at home? Or wasting our money on wars around the world that make people hate us and turn against us and turn to terrorism? We hear so often, no one wants war. It's not true. It's never been true. There are powerful forces who want war because they profit from war. The old saying, cui bono, who profits? Still, follow the money. That's still the answer here. Those who profit are the ones who want the war. You know, in all of history, people who produce war goods, the weapons, that sort of thing, have always been wealthy, always been powerful, the war profiteers. But if you look at US history, more recently, in the period right after 9/11, in that first year, the war profiteers, the CEOs of war-producing companies, got a 200% raise on average. All the other overpaid CEOs got a 7% raise. Now you tell me they don't want war. They want war because it's profitable. They want war because they want a market for all of their military goods. And they find it. Because we are told over and over again it's either war or nothing. And that's the lie. It's It's the lie that George Bush told us overtly. It's the lie that current administrations and Congresses continue to act on. So we have this ongoing conflict in the region, across the region. Some of them new, some are old. The question of Israel-Palestine remains central to the crisis in the region. If you look at the positive days of the Arab Spring, when it looked so hopeful, so optimistic, that citizens' organizations, citizens' movements, democratic movements were rising all around the region, and the demands were the demands of the rights of citizenship, and the demands were for jobs and for bread. They were basic rights. But if you talk to any of those activists, you didn't have to scratch the surface very hard to find out that part of the anger that motivated it was seeing how Palestinians were being treated over the decades, seeing the expansion of settlements, seeing the siege of Gaza continuing over and over again, and every 2 years a new assault on Gaza with thousands of Palestinian deaths and no accountability. No one held accountable. War crimes identified and seen around the world, and no one held accountable because the United States continued to protect Israel in the United Nations. So we have this colonial reality that shapes so much of the history of the rest of the world. The Arab world has not forgotten British and French colonialism. You know, we hear about ISIS saying that the colonial border between Iraq and Syria is no more. The Sykes-Picot lines in the sand should be abolished. But they're hardly the first ones to say that. They're the first ones to take up arms to make it happen at a horrific human price. But they're not the first ones to say the colonial powers have destroyed our region, stolen our oil, destroyed our people. And the leftover colonial expansion is going on inside Israel, enabled by the United States, with the European Union rebuilding Gaza every time it's destroyed, and then standing back and not holding Israel accountable where it goes in and destroys it again. The irony, of course, we're talking about extremists. We're talking about the extremism of ISIS that operates in the name of Islam. In the settlements in the West Bank and East Jerusalem, it's about 650,000 people who are violating international law every morning just by getting out of bed because their houses are built on illegally expropriated land. But only about 20% of them, maybe 25%, are extremists, either religious or nationalist extremists. The rest are what we might call yuppie settlers. They move to the West Bank for the same reasons that people in this country move to the suburbs. The air is cleaner, the houses are bigger, the lawns are greener, the swimming pools are sparklinger. What's not to like? And it's all subsidized by the Israeli government, helped along by our tax money. We pay $3.1 billion a year directly to the Israeli military. It's soon going to go up to five. The new 10-year agreement is being negotiated right now, and it looks like that's going to be part of the payoff to Israel after the Iran deal. The consolation prize is that it's going to go from $3.1 billion a year to the military to $5 billion a year to the military. $5 billion every year of our tax money going to the military of the 26th wealthiest country in the world for their military, which is known around the world for committing war crimes. Is that a good use of our tax money? Is that going to make us safer? These are the questions that are not being asked enough. We use the term apartheid when we talk about this colonial enterprise, not because it's a shocking term and it gets people talking about how can you say Israel is apartheid, it's not like South Africa. The answer is, of course, it's not like South Africa. It's completely different. That's not why we use the term. We use the term because it's the exact definition of apartheid that's included in the UN Covenant Against the Crime of Apartheid that was passed in 1973. That says that when you have a single territory with two separate legal systems governed by the same government, where people are divided on the basis of race or religion, national origin or language, that's the definition of apartheid. Look at the West Bank. Imagine a 12-year-old kid on the West Bank throws a stone. If that kid is an Israeli kid, he's going to be taken to a juvenile court. Very much like our courts. They don't work well all the time, but the idea of juvenile courts is they are built to to work in the interest of the child. The child is considered a child, even if they have committed a crime. The goal of the court is to help get the kid education and help whatever is needed to get the kid back on track. That's appropriate. That's what would happen to an Israeli kid in the West Bank. If that kid in the West Bank who throws a stone is a 12-year-old Palestinian kid, that kid appears before a military court. Israel is the only country in the world that has created a juvenile military court. At 14, Palestinian kids, Israeli kids are in a juvenile court up to 18. At 14, Israeli kids go before the regular military court, with all that that implies. So this is the definition of apartheid, and it's the reason that we talk about solutions that apply across the board. We need a solution to the war in Syria that's based on international law, human rights, and equality for all. We need an end to Israeli occupation and apartheid and a solution to the Israeli-Palestinian conflict that's based on international law and human rights and equality for all. Whether it's one state, two state, red state, blue state, that's not our call. That's not for the US. I'm a Jewish girl from California. I don't live there. Why should I get to say how many states there are? It's not my job. My job is to hold my government accountable for a policy to be based on international law and human rights and equality for all, instead of a policy that's based on supporting occupation and apartheid. In Syria, my job is to say we need to stop supporting militarization and war and start supporting diplomacy and negotiations. We need to stop paying billions of dollars to buy weapons and start paying billions of dollars to rebuild the countries we have destroyed. That's our job. That's the kind of work that we need to focus on. I want to end with two points. One is something that former Senator George Mitchell taught all of us, I think, after his work in the Good Friday Accord in Northern Ireland that he was instrumental in helping to craft. And after that very long process, which had been almost impossible at the beginning, partly because the British view was the provisional IRA are terrorists and we will not talk to them. They cannot be in the room. And the lesson that Senator Mitchell brought back and what he had imposed at the time was, if you're serious about diplomacy, everybody has to be in the room. Not because you like them, but precisely because you don't. And if they're not in the room, they're not bound by whatever you decide. So this notion that we can have talks in Syria with the Syrian Kurds, who are admittedly the US's best friend in the region, who are fighting ISIS more than anybody else, but they can't be there because Turkey won't come if they're there, that's not going to work. You don't have to like what the Kurds stand for. You don't have to like what Turkey stands for. But they're on opposite sides, and if they're not both in the room, one or the other is going to scuttle the deal. So that's the pragmatism of it. That's the pragmatic part, that everybody has to be in the room. That's not idealist. That's being pragmatic. The one other thing I want to say is that this notion that the only option is the option of war is a very dangerous reality for our country. The idea of American exceptionalism, which is now touted as a given, something to be held up with pride by every candidate for president of every party. No one is willing to say, no, we are not exceptional. We are exceptionally wealthy and exceptionally powerful, but we are not an exceptional nation. We are a nation struggling to do what we claim to believe in, that we claim to believe in things like equality, and we struggle to make that real. We are not exceptional. We got a lot of work to do. But we do have obligations, the obligations that come with power and that come with money, all of those things that we have too much of. We don't have too much humility. We could use a little more of that. But it means that we need real policies. It's not enough to say, we can't go to war. It's not going to work. The option is not walk away. The option is not, this is not a Rand Paul isolationism. You know, once in a while, he says something very interesting on the need to end wars, the need not to send troops. I'm like, yeah, that sounds good. Until he gets to, yeah, we have to pull out of the United Nations and stop dealing with any other countries. Okay, this is, you know, that's not going to work so well either. So what would a policy look like? If we are talking about a policy based on human rights and equality for all and international law, maybe we start with the Hippocratic Oath. First, do no harm. Stop killing more people. If you're trying to stop a war that has already in Syria killed more than 250,000 people, stop killing more people in the name of stopping the war. That could be number one. That's not a bad idea. Number two, you claim there are no boots on the ground. Make that real. Pull them out. Pull out the 3,700 troops that are on the ground in Iraq and the 50 or so that are officially on the ground in Syria. We don't know how many more. All those special forces and CIA ops, maybe they wear sneakers and not boots, but get them out too. Get them all out. Get all the shoes out. Get all the shoes out. They're making it worse and not better. Number three, stop sending more weapons for all these forces to be killing each other. Stop sending more bombs and bombers to the Saudis to kill more Yemenis. Stop sending more, whatever they're sending, in tanks and trucks and more bombs and more bullets to the so-called Syrian opposition that the US doesn't even know who they're sending it to, not least because almost all of it ends up in the hands of ISIS. Because ISIS is stronger. We remember why. One, they don't fight alone, they fight with others. Number two, they pay higher wages to their militias. That's one of the ironies of it all. Number four, five, six, 10, do better diplomacy. Put all of the money and energy and high-level attention into the diplomacy that we're now putting into the war. And in the meantime, stop the war to make that diplomacy real. Use the money to vastly increase our contributions to the United Nations to take care of refugees. The vast majority of refugees don't want to come here. They're not trying to invade our country. They don't want to be in the United States. They want to be able to go home. Some of them do have to be resettled, and we should take more. We should be taking 28% of those refugees who do need to be resettled. Why? Because we represent 28% of the wealth of the world, even though we only have 5% of the population of the world. The least we could do is say we will take 28% of those refugees who need resettlement. There's small things we can do. We could overturn the Supreme Court decision Holder versus Humanitarian Law Project. Why? Because that law makes it illegal for anyone in the United States to provide nonviolence training to any organization on the terrorism list. So if somebody could get to the PKK, the Kurdish Workers Party in Turkey, or ISIS for that matter, and train some of them in nonviolent techniques of protest instead of war, that would be a crime punishable by 20 years in a federal prison. How sensible is that? That's a small thing. We should be able to do that. We can increase economic pressure on the oil companies that are making a killing on ISIS oil. Now, what government is going to be prepared to put the pressure on the oil companies? That shouldn't be so hard. Given that we claim that everything about our country is mobilized to stop terrorism, except, well, the oil companies, they're kind of exempt. There's a lot to do. And at the end of the day, we still owe a huge debt to the people of Syria. We still owe an enormous debt to the people of Iraq and Afghanistan and Yemen and Somalia, the countries where we are sending drones, the people of the countries that we have destroyed. Some of you will remember, looking around, I think many of you will remember, Colin Powell's claim during the Iraq War. Remember his famous statement that he used to say over and over again, the, the Pottery Barn line, you break it, you fix it. We have to fix Iraq. That was the wrong analogy. It's not about Pottery Barn. The right analogy is the bull in the china shop. What do you do when the bull gets loose in the china shop? You don't go in and ask the bull to fix all the cups. You get the bull the hell out of the china shop and write a check for the damage. That's what we need to be doing in Iraq. That's what we need to be doing in Afghanistan. It's going to be generations before these countries can reclaim their social existence, their lives, rebuild their cities. It's not going to help to have us standing there with guns telling them how to do it. That's the guarantee of failure. We need to guarantee success. We've had 15 years of a failed war on terror. I think maybe it's time for 15 years of paying the price for what we did wrong. Thank you.
Just a very quick remark. I kept dreaming about if I can take you and Robert Gates for a drink, and then we have a discussion, how exciting that would
be. In your dreams.
Sure, sure.
I'd go. I'm not sure his Secret Service people would like that.
Okay. I appreciate all what you are saying, but I am from the area as well, and I lived here in the U.S. long enough to have two questions. And I would like, please, specific answers. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Number one, there are anti-war activists in America, but there is no anti-war movement. So who are you talking to when you say we should and we shouldn't? Mm. Because politicians, quite frankly, would listen to the money Adelson and his company pay more than anybody else that I am aware of. That's number one. Number two, and I don't mean to put you on the spot as a Jew, but quite frankly, like Robert Kagan and his wife, Paul Wolfowitz and Elliot Cohen and Crystal, like Carl Bernstein said it bluntly on television, the Jewish neocons are trying to redraw the map of the whole world. Yeah. So would you like to comment on that, please?
Sure. The second one first. Jewish neocons are a huge problem. So are Christian neocons. The defense of Israel is central to neocon approaches for both the Jews and the Christians. So I think that's the issue we need to deal with, is neoconservative theories that have given rise to these wars. It's not the fact that they're Jewish, it's that they are supporters of Israel. That's the problem. Supporters of the militarist, the most militarist tendencies in Israel, no doubt. Now the broader question you raise, the first question, I think is a very, very difficult and very important one. What has happened to the peace movement? I wish I had an easy, glib answer. I don't. There are movements that are on the rise across this country at this moment. The movement in the Fight for 15, Seattle has played a huge role in that. The Black Lives Matter movement has transformed our understanding of racism in a new generation. The renewed fight to defend women's reproductive freedom is taking a whole new level of energy. It's incredibly exciting. The labor movement is actually growing for the first time in a long time. The restaurant workers and other parts of the movement. The immigrant rights movement, hugely important. The anti-war movement is not. And I take that as a personal failure because it's the work that I've done for many, many years. And it's what I struggle with literally every day of my life these days. I don't have an answer. I have some theories of why the movement collapsed in size and capacity when it did, around 2008, around the time of the collapse of the economy and the time of the election of President Obama. All of those were factors. But I also recognize that even at our height of power and influence and size, we never then, and we will never have money to compete with the neocons or pro-Israel forces or other lobbies like that, nor do the Fight for 15 or the Black Lives Matter, they don't have money either. We need a different kind of movement. We need, in my view, and the question is how to build it, a movement that rather than focusing on building a very strong, independent, separate peace movement, in an era like now, when, despite all the propaganda, the wars are not the main thing affecting people's lives across this United States. It's the economic inequality that is destroying people's lives, and that's the focus. We need to be getting information about the cost of wars, the cost of militarism, like those examples I gave you about the cost to Washington State and the trade-offs of how those decisions get made, into the hands of every one of those movements. We need to be looking at how war policies, like the drug war in Colombia, for instance, the anti-gang war in this country that led to the violence that is racking Honduras and El Salvador, what that does to the immigration crisis. All of these things are linked. And we have an obligation to get one set of that information into the hands of broader movements. That's not a whole answer, but I think it's part of what we need to be doing. There are amazing levels of work going on, particularly on the question of Palestine, where the discourse shift has been extraordinary in recent years. The normalization of opposing Israeli occupation and apartheid is unprecedented for me after 30 years on working on this issue. The last 5, 6, 7 years has been amazing. It has not yet translated into any change of policy. The discourse has to change first, but that can't be the end of the day. We still have to move to the harder stage of transforming a discourse shift into a policy shift. On the war issues, we're not even at the level of discourse shift. We don't yet have a moment where we could say people understand why going to war against terrorism will never work. So that's still the level of education that we have to be doing. I wish I had a better answer. I wish I could tell you, oh, we need a new peace movement? Yeah, here's my checklist, 1, 2, 3. I don't know the answer. I don't know the answer. But I'm glad you asked the question because I think it's one that all of us have to take very, very seriously. So thank you.
Why are you leaving out the elephant in the room, which is the active support, creation, funding by the United States, by its allies, Saudi Arabia, Turkey, Israel, of ISIS and these other elements like ISIS?
Okay.
It's not, hold on, I'm not done.
Apparently.
And why this is going on and how this plays into the proxy war being directed against the emerging nations of the BRICS, China, Russia, India, and they are moving for massive development in the Middle East. I don't know if people know what Xi Jinping did in China, did in the Middle East. But he's saying, we will build you up all the way.
Okay, thank you. Very important question. The question of U.S. and Saudi support for ISIS is a longstanding issue. The U.S. support came in the form of creating the conditions which gave rise to ISIS and imprisoning the people who would ultimately create ISIS. The issue of where the money comes from is a very complicated one. Much of it, if you had to pick one country that the money for ISIS comes from, it comes from Saudi Arabia. We've known that for a long time. That's one of the big questions of what are the Saudis doing and not doing to stop the money from going through. It goes to the question of what is Turkey doing or not doing to prevent fighters from going through. That's an ongoing question. These are countries allied with the US. This is a huge challenge to the US claims that it is against ISIS in all its forms when its allies have been responsible. One of the things we don't know, because the system in Saudi Arabia is so opaque, is the degree to which the money that goes from the Saudis to ISIS comes from the royal family versus coming from some government officials versus coming from pro-government institutions of various sorts versus coming from wealthy Saudi individuals or businesses. No one's been able to track that. We know it comes from Saudi Arabia. We don't know how much of it comes from the government or not the government. What we do know, and what nobody's hiding this, this is all over my book, which you can read. One of the things that we do know is that the Saudi system is tightly controlled enough that regardless of whether the money was coming from government sources or not, the government does have the capacity to stop it. It's choosing not to do that. The US is choosing to not pressure them to do that because of relations of oil and relations of weapons sales. Those are still the things that define the US-Saudi relationship. So yeah, that hasn't changed. I don't think that's the only elephant in the room, but yeah, it's one of the things that hasn't changed. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm sure you have some thoughts about how this could happen in a wonderful world, but the way things are actually playing out, I'm curious as to what you think the future of Israel is going to be.
I think Israel is going through a very rough time on one level, but it hasn't quite, I think, internalized that in terms of the majority from what polls indicate and the government. The government, as you all know, has been moving farther and farther to the right. Netanyahu is very much a centrist in Israel. It's really a mistake to see Netanyahu as the right wing, because in the context of his government, he's very much a centrist. His accountability is to three parties that are much further to his right. And the unfortunate, really terrible part is that the polls all indicate that the youth in Israel are far further right, far more consolidated right wing than the older people. So that's a very bad sign, as is the fact that, again, according to polls, 40% of the IDF now are either settlers or people who identify with pro-settler parties, which makes the military a much more ideological instrument than it used to be. All of this, I think, is very, very dangerous. I think that one of the great values of the BDS movement, the Boycott, Divestment, Sanctions movement, which has been initiated originally by Palestinian civil society back in 2005 and is now a global movement for bringing nonviolent economic pressure to bear on Israel, both directly through Israeli banks and that sort of thing, and by pressuring corporations who are profiting from Israeli occupation and apartheid. It's the first time that ordinary Israelis are just beginning to see that they are paying a price for the occupation. In general, Israelis have not paid a price. The new report that just came out from Human Rights Watch, some of you may have seen it, it just came out about 2 or 3 days ago, indicates how much of a profit Israel is making from the occupation, with enormous costs, of course, being borne by the Palestinians. But the problem of a country in which 25% of its population is explicitly and legally second-class citizens, there are 50 separate laws that discriminate between the rights of Jews and the rights of non-Jews or Palestinians inside Israel, let alone occupying another entire people illegally, is becoming something that will start to force Israelis to pay a price. And I think that's where we'll see the parallel with South Africa, when white South Africans who were obsessed with sports suddenly realized that because of apartheid, their beloved Springboks were not going to be able to play in the World Cup. That was led to a dramatic shift in white support for apartheid. It began that enormous slide down that allowed the banks to start negotiating their way out of it. In Israel, it's not so much sports. Sports aren't that big of a deal in Israel. Culture and science is. And so the academic and cultural boycotts that are part of the BDS movement are having an enormous impact. So you have, for example, the Reut Foundation. It's a kind of centrist think tank, something like Brookings, I suppose, in the Israeli context, issued a report a year and a half ago about what's the biggest threat to Israel. And this was at the moment when Netanyahu was saying the biggest threat to Israel is Iran, it's an existential threat, et cetera. And they said, no, the biggest threat to Israel is the BDS movement, which is kind of shocking when you think about it. A nonviolent movement that's never even been, you know, accused of any sort of violence is being identified as the biggest threat because it threatens the legitimacy of the Israeli project of expanding settlements, of expelling Palestinians, of all of that. So that's where I think Israel is in trouble. And I think what's ultimately going to happen, I said before, and I believe that it's not my call whether it's one state or two states. I don't think I have any say in the matter. But as an analyst looking at the situation, I don't see how a two-state solution is going to happen. I don't think there's any land left. You know, they just announced another 350 acres south of Jericho is now going to be defined as state land. The entire Jordan Valley has now been identified as a military zone. I mean, this means there's no land for a viable state. So that means some version of a civil rights movement for equal rights, for everybody living in that territory under a government. How that plays out, I'm afraid, is going to be very, very, very harsh for Palestinians, far more than for Israelis. But for Israelis, it's not going to be so easy either. It's going to be a rough time for everybody.
My question is about the, I'm saying it wrong, but the Armageddon or something, that people say that ISIS is saying, it's, you know, that, you know, we need a world war that'll kill.
Yeah. Yeah, it's this thing about end days. And it's similar in some ways to, there's Christian fundamentalists who have a similar view of end days. And in fact, it gives rise to the movement known as Christian Zionism, which is based on a religious belief that the second coming of Christ can't happen until all the Jews are gathered in one place. And then they either convert or die, which I gotta say, as a Jew, is not my favorite choice to have, but whatever. You ask Israelis about that, and they say, well, yeah, but we don't believe that. We don't think that's true, but we will take them as allies in the meantime. This is not a funny thing. This is actually very serious. It is thoroughly anti-Semitic in that classic sense. It really calls for the death of Jews. But it's the reason that organizations like KUFI, Christians United for Israel, under Reverend Hagee, organizations like that support not only Israel as a state, but the Zionist project of the ingathering of all the Jews, the encouraging of all Jews to go to the Promised Land. And once they're all there, there will be this choice. They will either convert or die, and then the second coming can happen. So it's kind of a precursor. The ISIS version, which comes out of a kind of Salafi, it's a particular version of Islam, has a similar view of what they've done with the caliphate. They're not prepared to wait to create the caliphate. We're just going to build it now. You know, we're going to build it on this land that we're going to steal from some other people and create this caliphate. And there will be a final battle. The name of their magazine, their English language online magazine, is called Dabiq. And that's the name of a small town, a village, really, in Syria that ISIS claims is going to be the site of the final battle between good and evil, or between their side and the Crusaders. You know, it gets defined in different ways, but it's basically the final battle of Armageddon. So that's the sort of apocalyptic view, and they see themselves living through those end times. This is one of the ways that theologically they differ from, say, Al-Qaeda or other extremist Muslim organizations. They have an entirely different view of this that isn't shared, you know, beyond that. So
I appreciate the ideas you've been raising. And I want to take us back to 2004, and I want to get your sense about this. I couldn't agree more that the seeds of ISIS started in 2004. And there's a group of us who feel very strongly that our country is guilty of war crimes, our senior leadership, based on the fact that there were false premises that were known to be false, that were the justification to go in. We know weapons of mass destruction is a big issue. And the evidence was that there was virtually no evidence of any weapons. And the same thing, capacity for nuclear war, none of that exists. And then the final one was that they were connected with Al-Qaeda and the 9/11. What I'm wondering is, what, you know, you've done a lot of research. I believe that there's a basis for war crimes. As a practical, I don't think it's going to happen. Well, I'd just be interested in your observation, what your thoughts are, because what has evolved as a result of a preemptive attack where there was no threat to our international security, we've now unleashed horrible chaos in the Middle East.
You know, you raise a very important point. I think the issue of accountability is crucial. I do think that war crimes have been committed. I think that there are war criminals in particularly the earlier administration, the Bush administration. Some have been continued by the current administration. But I think there's no question that in a just world, either national courts or an international court would hold George Bush and Dick Cheney and Donald Rumsfeld and a host of others to trial on war crimes charges.
I agree with you that that's not very likely to happen, but I think that the identification of war crimes is a very important part of our collective understanding of ourselves as a nation. Do we take responsibility for what our governments do in our name, or do we not? You know, the rise of organizations that were called Not In My Name in various sorts, the organizations like the 9/11 Families for Peaceful Tomorrows, this was a huge, important organization that were key to the peace movement in the United States. People who had lost loved ones in the attacks of 9/11, who said, you will not go to war in my brother's name, in my mother's name, in my father's name, in my daughter's name. I will not allow you to do that without protest. That was huge as a moral statement of how one can function in this society. When we see our tax money being used to fund horrific weapons around the world, when we see our government completely unaccountable to the demands of people to stop wars, to bring the troops home, and it gets ignored. So I absolutely agree with the importance of talking about war crimes, raising it with the International Criminal Court. It was raised, it was brought to the prosecutor of the International Court of Justice, to the International Criminal Court in 2008, I believe it was. And the court, to their credit, did at least do a creditable examination of the evidence and ended up deciding that they did not have jurisdiction because US courts were available for such things. But the model was there. It was a symbolic gesture, and that was important. So I think it is very important to keep the issue of war crimes very central in our own understanding of what our actions have done. Because if you talk about war crimes, it makes it a little bit easier, just a little bit, to envision, to imagine, to evoke what those actions, those strategies look like at the other end of the gun, the people who are the recipient of our strategies. So yes, I think that's a very important point. Thank you.
Well, thank you. Do you know what percentage of the, I guess they're refugees that are Muslim? The people that are on the move trying to get to Europe? Mm. Do you know what percentage?
I don't. I know that about half, about 55% are Syrian.
From Syria.
And of the Syrians, I would guess that it's slightly less, the percentage of Christians in Syria is something like 3 or 4%. Okay. I would guess that the percentage of refugees among them is less because they tend to be somewhat more protected than most Muslims. So I would imagine that of those 55% that are Syrians, the vast majority are Muslim.
Why do you think that the wealthy Muslim countries are not willing to take Muslim refugees when culturally and religiously they would be much closer than Sweden or Germany?
Well, first of all, they're not. Many of those countries are not closer politically and culturally. They may be Muslim. That's a very wide range. That's like saying that anybody who lives in the U.S. could be just as happy living in southern Nigeria, which is Christian. You know, it's not just about religion. Most of the refugees have no interest in going to the Gulf. They're incredibly repressive. They don't want to go there. They're looking for freedom and independence. They're not just looking for Islam. So that's a big part of the reason. The reason those countries don't want to accept them is that they are right-wing, reactionary, fundamentalist in some cases, secular in others, but they are not democratic or welcoming or interested in bringing in anyone who's not a citizen of their own country. Look, we're talking about Gulf countries where, for example, in Qatar, the percentage, the whole population of the country is about 2 million, and of those, something like 800,000 or less are actually citizens. The rest are so-called guest workers who have no rights in the country. So that's the countries we're dealing with. These are not countries that are known for being generous to anybody.
So I haven't read your book yet, unfortunately. I'll get to that.
Good.
I don't know if the answer to my question is in your book already, but I was a little confused. I wanted you to elaborate on the connection between the rise of ISIS, and you mentioned the Arab Spring, of course, and then the connection to Israel. And actually, I spent a lot of time in Ramallah during the Arab Spring, and the sentiment was actually the opposite. Most of the youth, that's who I associate with, were very inspired by the Arab Spring. Mm-hmm. I don't know what happened in Damascus. I don't know what happened in Cairo, if it was the other way. But I'm just trying to understand the connection between Israel and the rise of ISIS.
It seems to me there were two things. One is exactly what you're saying. I think that young Palestinians, and I think young people around the world, not only in the region, were incredibly inspired by the uprisings of the Arab Spring. I think particularly, I mean, the rise of what Al Jazeera English did globally to bring the voices of protesters in Tahrir Square into the homes of people all around the world was huge in terms of giving voice to the idea that you could fight for the rights of citizenship, that sort of thing. That was huge. What I meant before was not so much that people were looking to Palestine for models, although I think there was a way in which the first intifada, the intifada of the stones, which was overwhelmingly nonviolent, et cetera, was seen in some arenas as a model for what mobilization could look like. But that's not what I had in mind. What I had in mind was more the sense that the anger that was part of what drove the Arab Spring all across the region included an anger at how governments in the region, for example, in Tahrir Square, people were very angry at how Mubarak had allied himself with the US and Israel against the interest of Palestinians. There was a sense that their governments had betrayed the Palestinians, and that was part of why they were angry at their own governments. So that was the link that I was drawing there in terms of the inspiration side of things. Yeah, I'm sorry if that wasn't clear. Yeah.
Before I ask my question, I have a need to thank you and Dennis Halliday and Hans von Sponeck and all the people that stood up and spoke about the sanctions in the 1990s.
Thank you.
And as an additional reason, I was one of those people that stood up so that you won't think of me as a bit crazy person for the question I want to ask next.
Oh, dear.
Somebody said they know me. The question is, how do you understand the issue of September 11th? That's the issue that's not spoken about almost anywhere publicly.
I will tell you how I understand it. Understand it as an attack by planes that were driven by the people we were told they were driven by. And I think there were lots of people in Washington who knew that problems like that could happen, and there was information that was not shared, and that people may well have known about it and didn't do anything about it. I also think that there are lots of unanswered questions that we're probably never going to find answers to. What I don't think, and what I'm not going to say any more about than this one sentence, is that the reason I don't think it was a, quote, inside job is that I am absolutely 100% sure it would not have remained secret, that there would have been hundreds of people who would have leaked it by now. So that's what I think about it. One more question.
Hi, okay. Actually, that's somewhat what... I have two things, two quick things. One, it's actually interesting, this gentleman just raised...
we're not going to talk about that anymore, so...
No. In 2002, the September 11th commission report on the whole issue was released, and there was a section in there that relevantly was classified, the 28 pages.
28 pages, yeah.
Which Bob Graham, the senator who was the co-chairman, said very repeatedly and publicly that if that 28 pages had been released by now, that there would not have been ISIS, there would not have been the terrorist attacks in Paris, there'd be a different Middle East because of the question of Saudi Arabia. So that's one question for you, just on your thoughts on that. The other question that I've just been reflecting on in the course of your remarks tonight, you said that you can't defeat ISIS militarily, that it has to be something without bombs. And it was brought up earlier, actually, that the Chinese have been in the new Silk Road policy, which has been sweeping through at least portions of the Middle East, have publicly said to Syria, we would like to bring you, at least the parts that aren't in total warfare and chaos currently, into infrastructure development, into a serious industrial and infrastructure perspective, which, it seems to me that this has to ring a certain note, because it it isn't about winning a war at that point. It's actually about something more fundamental, or about what is your sense of human society and dealing with a certain moral collapse.
Yeah, I mean, I think that the Chinese efforts in the Middle East, like their efforts in Africa, have everything to do with Chinese interests and nothing to do with African or Arab interests. That's what I think China is doing with its new Silk Road policy. That doesn't mean that everything they do is bad or wrong. It's just that I don't think their orientation is the concern about the countries in which they're operating. On the question of the 28 pages, which documents the role of Saudi Arabia in 9/11, and we don't really know what it says beyond that, yeah, I'd love to see it too. I tend to think that Bob Graham is exaggerating when he says that everything would have been different, because it implies that the knowledge of how bad Saudi Arabia is would somehow have transformed government policies having to do with buying oil and selling weapons. And I don't think it would have changed it that much. I'm too much of a cynic. Maybe he's more of an idealist than I am, but I don't quite believe that. But I do appreciate the questions. I think if anything else, it indicates how much work we all have to do to change these approaches, and changing this notion that there's always a military answer to any challenge. It's not the case, it never has been, but we have to fight to make that real. Thank you.